Okay, are we in the right place? There's no, yeah, there's, yes, there's. Okay. Let's all take one deep breath. Let's do that again. What the fuck is he doing? Okay, here I am. I'm here now.
You're here now. Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you.
Are you enjoying your stay in Buffalo? There's only one answer to this, by the way.
If they let me out to see Buffalo, I'd probably like it.
Stick around till Tuesday or Wednesday next week. So,
I understand you have a waterfall thing.
Buffalo.
Yeah, it's not really Buffalo.
Oh, no?
No. Oh. We like it. But we only visit when people are from out of town.
I usually come in from Canada.
You come up through Canada and come down in?
Yeah, because the Canadian side is more civil.
Right,
doll. Canada.
No. Any Canadians in the audience?
Only Americans. Only Americans don't want to be Canadian. Okay.
So,
I'm a little goofy, I admit it. Because I've been signing autographs and like that. And that's not a way to make a living. And so it'll take me a little while for my brain to settle in. Here, hold on a second. Could you hold that?
Sure.
Okay. Better.
Ready?
Yep.
Okay. So you're a guy growing up in New York City in the 50s. Different industry than it is today, certainly the movie industry. What was your inspiration? What got Richard Dreyfuss on stage and on screen? What was the thing that got you going?
Just to slightly change that, I was born in Brooklyn.
Yeah.
And raised in Bayside, Long Island. And everyone in Bayside was either a communist or a socialist. So I never met a Democrat until I was 14. And I wouldn't have liked them. I'm what they call a red diaper baby. And I was of the left, the old-fashioned left. But we moved out when I was 8 or 9 and came to LA. And when you're in LA, that's like 20 feet from Beverly Hills. And so we wanted to go to Beverly Hills. And then you go to school with everyone's kid. All the movie stars' kids, you know. So, and it was normal life to see Loretta Young in the Rolls Royce in the next lane. And I actually had the experience of having just stolen the Big Life magazine History of the Movies book. I had just stolen it, and I was sitting in my friend's car, which was an open car, convertible, and I was looking at this big red book, and this Rolls Royce pulls up, and it was Loretta Young. And she looked down and she smiled. And she looked exactly like Loretta Young looked in the 30s. It was like amazing. And I thought she was going to say, you owe that man $34, so you steal the book. But I said, I bet you're in the book. And she said, she smiled. She went, I bet I am. And somewhere around there, I was a committed person. I knew that I was going to do that. And when I was sitting in the kitchen one morning, and I said to my mother, I'm going to be an actor. And she said, don't just talk about it. So I got up, I went to the Jewish Community Center on Olympic Boulevard, auditioned for a play, and never stopped. And I was either in a play, or in a scene, in a workshop, or in a TV pilot or some show, or something, without a break until I was 27. And when I was 27 years old, I had a vacation. I had not, in all those years, this is true, I had not, since I was 9 years old, ever had 10 days without me acting in something. And I knew, like you know the sun rises in the morning, that I was going to be an actor, that I was an actor. And I knew that I would succeed, I'd be a star. And everyone thought that I was nuts, and rather unpleasantly nuts, because of my certainty. I didn't yell at people about it, but when asked, I would say, I'm in no hurry, I'm going to make it, doesn't matter. And I loved being an unemployed actor in LA. I actually taught a class after I won the Academy Award. I taught a class, and it was called How to Be an Unemployed Actor. And I had 600 people in my class, and I interviewed casting directors and agents and showrunners and writers. And I really did try to teach them what I had experienced for 11 years. And they listened to everything I said, except one thing. And that thing got so notorious that 12, 15 years later, people still come up and argue about it. And it was this. I told them that I thought that having photos and a resume was a waste of money, and you didn't need it. I thought it was, just one idea, right? And hands go up. And they all said, no, you have to have. And I said, no, you don't. And I gave them this analysis. What do you need a picture for? To give them, to make them remember you, right? Right. You think that when you leave the office that they're going to say, put that in the most interesting file? Or do you think they're going to get thrown in the brown file garbage bag? That's where they're going. If you want to analyze this, just remember, you want to be remembered. So I do what I did. I said, when they said, leave your picture here, I would say, I don't have a picture. And they'd look up and think I was odd. And I would say, I'd rather run my car through the wall of this office than you'd remember me. And I never had to, because just saying that made them remember me. And I mean, I loved being unemployed. I loved occasionally getting a job and occasionally turning a job down. And when I turned a job down, I meant I was turning down, like a one-liner or a two-liner. And I had friends who took me out to lunch one day and said, you have to stop this. You can't do this. This is like, it's wrong. You're going to be blacklisted. I said, bullshit. It's going to make me a star. Oh, really? They said. How is that? And I said, simple. They're going to say, okay, what is he going to do if we offer him this? And that offer was bigger or better. And that's what happened. And that's why I got better and better and bigger until I was offered my own shows. Because I wanted to be a star. That's different than wanting to be an actor. It can include it, and in my case, it did. I wanted to be a great actor, but I also wanted to be a star. And that meant that I had to be singular. I had to find a personality that they found singular, eccentric, slightly different, memorable. And that's what you do. You want to feel, a star is someone who makes you feel comfortable and affectionate and someone you like to visit, but he also has a sense of maybe danger, maybe a little, you never can tell. And you can't tell me any romantic leading man that does not have a sense about him of trying to overcome a great love wound. Every romantic star has it. The best example is Humphrey Bogart in Casablanca. You know the minute he appears on screen that he's wounded. Every star has it. Every romantic star. I wasn't a romantic star. I was a something. And I was singular. I was the guy they couldn't put in that compartment. And for years, that's exactly what I was. The guy you couldn't put there, but you couldn't put there. All right, let's leave his picture outside on the top of the file. Because I was me, and I didn't have a threat, and I wasn't dangerous. I was maybe someone in the family. Is he a cousin? Why is he so familiar? Why is it so much fun when he's around? I can't quite place it. And that's what happened to me. And I got offers that were a little wacky. And all that time, I knew that I was taking a shot at something that was in fact divine and spiritually enormous. That I believed and believe now that acting as an art form is capable of the most powerful impact on you. Greater than music and greater than writing and greater than dance, and that acting, portraying you up here, I know that actors can rip your heart out and throw it on the ground, pick it up and throw it right back into you in a millisecond. Or they can laugh. And when an actor makes an audience laugh, something divine is happening. Because comedy is a picture of you. And it is, as Shakespeare says, surcease from sorrow. And when you do a comedy and make people laugh, you realize, you can see that people who have lived in some level of pain and some dark and awful things that they've even forgotten about, don't factor it in. When you do a great comedy, somehow acting can reach into people and find these little fossilized pieces of pain and take them out of you. And when you make a whole audience laugh, it is the most religious experience, the most spiritual I've ever had. And I can't tell you how acting is at one time silly, And let's face it, we all look a little silly here, okay? But at the same time, it ennobles you. It ennobles me. And I wouldn't give that up for anything. And I knew it. You don't have to ask too many questions. I have to tell you this story.
It's fine with me. You're on a roll. Go for it, buddy.
When I was 16 years old, I was living in L.A. and I was a member of the Actors Studio and a thing called Theater West. And we were told that 2 weeks from now, this old has-been washed up yesterday's news British actor named John Gielgud would be coming to L.A. to do a show called The Ages of Man. And so me and my friends decided to go to this show together. We never heard of this guy. We go to the Huntington Hartford Theater, and at a certain point, this little guy walks out of the curtain and opened his mouth and spoke. And I bifurcated into two different people. One of them was sitting in the balcony with his friends watching this actor. And the other one was feeling awe for the first time. I did not know that an actor could do that. I did not know that that man's voice was so beautiful and his submission to great poetry was so permanent and real that I knew this was a semi-divine experience. I was having. And we've all taken enough drugs to know what that feels like. And I felt how lucky I was that I had chosen this field and that I didn't have to worry that my life would consist of second parts on Star Trek and, you know, holding up one of those power saying, look at that Cthulian. That I could be like John Gielgud. The Ages of Man are all, it's poetry from Shakespeare, and it's about the ages of man. The birth, youth, first love, sex, up, death. At the end of the show, I went backstage, and I saw him, he was standing at his dressing room door. And I walked up to him and I said, thank you. And he said, you're welcome. And I walked away. And I didn't say, thank you for saving my life, or thank you for ennobling my ambition, or any of that. I didn't say that. I was feeling it. And 20 years later, I was producing a show called A Constitutional Vaudeville. Funny, you don't look 200. And it was about the Constitution and the Bill of Rights, and we had created it for Disney. And we had lots of people in the show. Randy Newman was in it, and Liz McGovern, and all the people, the heavyweights of the 80s were there. And I needed a guy who was going to speak against the Constitution, like a member of the House of Lords. And I knew I had this idea. So I wrote this big speech. And I said, out of hell with it. We called Gielgud's agent and said I was doing this thing, and would he do this? One scene. And he said yes. And I flew out and I shot, and I went to the theater, to the place with the studio, and it was already in his outfit. And it was already lit. So I asked him to rehearse on film, I said. And we do it, and he did it perfectly. So I said, okay, let's do it for real. And he did it perfectly. So we did a safety perfectly, and then we changed the angle. Perfect. And then we changed a lens, and perfect. And we were done at 10:30 in the morning, which you can't do. You don't fly to London and shoot John Gielgud for an hour and a half and it's over. You don't do that. But I had done it. I was going to waste the rest of my day. This is stupid. So I sat down next to him and I said, it's great. How would you feel about doing it this way? I don't even remember what I said. And he said, oh, how interesting, dear boy. And he patted my knee. I got up, the camera rolled, and he did it my way perfectly. And so we were done. And John Gielgud appears in my show as a member of the House of Lords who derides the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. And that after we were finished, I told him the story when I was 16. I told him the whole thing. And he was great. And how many of you know Gielgud's work? How many of you don't know? Hands up. Okay. You could give yourself an enormous gift if you find something of his to watch. For instance, he was the butler in Arthur.
Marathon Man.
Oh.
He was the king in Beckett.
Okay.
He is not only a supremely brilliant actor, but he has an extraordinary sense of humor and wit. And he's just this little gay old man, you know? But there's a reason why in England they say Sir John. And I can only tell you that it was the most, I am so grateful for that experience. Because without it, I might have ended up saying to you, oh yeah, I was on that TV show, the one with the ears that came out. Please. No. It was more than that. It was great. And I knew that I could touch it.
Oh, some questions. Can we get some questions?
Yeah.
Actually, I met you earlier. I just thought about, since you love comedy, what was it like working with Jennifer Tilly and Jake Johansson and Let It Ride? Or Danny DeVito and Tin Man? And you already told me about What About Bob?
In Tin Man, I was shocked because I was working with Barry Levinson, wrote the script and directed, and Danny, and a whole slew of New York comics. And when I got to the set on the first day, Barry said, no rehearsal. And we all said, what do you mean? And he said, I don't want you to rehearse. I just want to shoot what you do. And I said, well, you know what I mean? We can just like do it once to see if we know we're in the same scene. And he said, no. And he, I don't know if that's the equivalent, but it felt like he was asking us to dive into an empty Olympic pool. But he knew something I didn't, because we were great. And we were all working together without rehearsal, and we just fit. And when you see this film, which most of you have not, you're going to see an amazing comedic ballet that goes on. And it's all about Baltimore scam artists. It's a great film. And then what was the other film you mentioned?
Let It Ride, when you were the
Let It Run.
And you were always losing at the racetrack, and then at the end you finally won a lot of money. Jennifer Tilly,
yeah.
And Jake Johansson was like your sidekick, I guess.
It's about the racing, you know, the racetrack. So anyone who ever comes up and says, I loved you in Let It Ride, I immediately say, and you're a degenerate gambler. And they always say, yes. And it is hysterical. It's absolutely hysterical, this movie. And it's, but you got to understand it. You know, when you walk in, understand, this is really about the racetrack. And really about the debtors and stuff. And so it wasn't about a guy who lost and lost and lost. It was about a guy that morning who won. And won again. And won again. And kept winning. And the show is about that. And it is hysterically funny. And if you like to laugh, which if you're human, you better say yes. You can go to see that film. And what was the other one?
What About Bobby? You already asked that when I met you earlier. Yeah. Or the Stakeout movies.
Well, the Stakeout, we had... how many of you have seen the Stakeout movies? How many of you have not? It's a funny thing because I actually have, in a sense, outlived myself. You know, I've lived, oh, wow, I love your work. And then I get, oh, God, my parents love your work. And then I get, oh, God, my grandmother would probably drop dead if you know, I was talking to her. And then I get, who are you? Who? Jaws. Oh, yeah, I saw it. It's kind of like the real story of The Walking Dead.
I don't know if someone asked it yet, but what was it like getting attacked by the shark in the movie?
It was a bummer. The problem is that in real life, the shark never worked. We were the only, we were the first movie ever, we didn't realize this, to try to be made on the real ocean. Every other movie you've ever seen on, about the water takes place in tanks that you can control. We thought that we can control the Atlantic Ocean. And they had not really perfected the shark yet, so that when it came up, it went, and then the thing would fall over. The shark is not working. The shark is not working. And we had to make a film without the shark. And Steven Spielberg had to reconceive what he was doing, because he couldn't use the shark, it looked fake, and it was always falling over. And that's why the film is so brilliant. Had he had a successful shark, he probably wouldn't have made as good a film. He had to imply, he had to invent the ominousness of something that was there, but couldn't see it, which was very much like the experience of really being in shark land. And he had a hell of a job. It wasn't just that he was making a movie. He was making a movie that didn't have a script, so we had to invent it as we went along, and we had to figure a way to tell the story. He figured out how to tell the story of these shark attacks without a shark. And I was asked at one point, would I go down to Australia and be in the shark cave? When the real great white, I said, don't finish the sentence. So it wasn't me. It was some other idiot.
When you accepted your Academy Award, you said you didn't have any speech prepared, and you beat John Travolta, Woody Allen. Was that because you didn't expect that you would win? And the second of all question is, what is an icon doing in front of us here at Buffalo?
Two fair questions.
Charge me for them?
The first question, okay. I actually didn't prepare a speech, and I actually did know that I would win. I knew it.
Wow.
Because actually, I sussed it out. I was told by my agent, and we were on vacation, and he called me and said, you've been nominated for Best Actor. And after I gasped, I said, who else? And he said, John Travolta, Woody Allen, Marcello Mastroianni, and Richard Burton. And I knew that John Travolta, too soon. They weren't going to do that, too soon. Woody Allen was that year the guy, because Annie Hall won best everything. Best actress, best screenplay, best film, best directing, and the Academy was not going to give it to him for best actor because they just didn't want to do that. And, you know, he might get a swelled head. So I knew I was like the default winner. Richard Burton was doing this. This is a lifetime. Acting. And Burton had just peaked, I felt. And that was my thinking. And no one would ever give Best Actor to a film they'd never seen or heard of, Marcello Mastroianni's movie, and so it was me. And I knew that. And I made a lot of money betting on me. A couple of years earlier, I was told I was going to be nominated for a film called The Apprenticeship of Judy Kravitz. And I said, no, I'm not. And they said, yes, you are. And I said, I'll bet you. And I won a lot of money. Then I won a lot of money after I was nominated. And before I got it. And then the year after I won, I made what can only be called a shitload of money. Because I would say, all right, for $100, who won Best Actor last year? And it was me. No one remembered. Which will tell you something about the Oscar. The Oscar is a great night and a great compliment, and it's a fantastic experience, and that's it. It doesn't say that you're the best. It doesn't say that you go to heaven. It doesn't say that you'll be rich and happy. It just says that performance gets an Oscar. And the list of people who never won an Oscar is just as noble and just as artistic as the ones who did. And I worked with Henry Fonda, who was a star from 1934 until he died. And I did a tour of a play with this man who was an awesome actor. He'd never been nominated. Now, he did win for his last film, which he did after we did the play. But winning an Oscar or not winning an Oscar is not... it's not the point. The point is to be hungry for it. And that's why I say, in my case, it happened too soon. Because I lost a certain part of my hunger. But if you're going to win an award, you might as well be an Oscar.
And Any other question?
Oh, what are
why an icon is here in front of us?
Well, there are two reasons. One is it affords me the ability to make a little money. And also, what I didn't understand until I got to the first one I did, it's the only opportunity that I have to say thank you to the people who watched my films. And I feel sad that they put out only basically the pictures from Jaws and Close Encounters. And what about Bob? And Mr. Holland's Office. Those films. And I say, I have the best list of great movies of any actor in Hollywood. And I mean it. I did films in the 80s, like Once Around and Let It Ride, and Rosencrantz and Guildenstern Are Dead, and others that I am so proud of. Now, maybe they didn't make money, but that ain't the point. And I can, however many movies it was that I made, I only could say that I didn't like maybe two. And I'll never tell you which one. So that's my opinion. I get to say thank you to you. Thank you.
Have you ever seen the John Belushi parody of you for the Goodbye Girl from Saturday Night Live? Do you enjoy being lampooned and parodied on television?
I saw it. I thought it was hysterical. Betty Davis had said in an interview once, you haven't arrived until you've been parodied. And so it was thrilling. It was really so exciting because my work had reached the culture. And every once in a while, I remember that. I went to Oxford in 2004, and I was not a student, I was what they called a senior research advisor for 4 years. And I was on the debate team. And I was introduced, my son was sitting here, my wife was over there, and they were introducing me as an icon of the culture. This is the first time I've ever heard this. An icon of the culture, and my son and I went. And I thought, well, that's a nice thing. I'd like a salary. I wouldn't mind a high paycheck. I wouldn't mind a great part. But it's nice being an icon of the culture. It doesn't get you coffee, but it is nice.
the movie, What About Bob? I don't know if you knew that it had a very therapeutic value, because I know for me it was a major inspiration towards me actually getting my doctorate and actually writing a self-help book of my own to help people who struggle with depression, because I do myself, and it was the first movie that I saw that actually made humor out of a dark situation, and it really inspired me that to actually laugh at myself and actually help I can actually help others that struggle as well, even while I'm struggling. So I don't know if you knew that What About Bob had that much of an impact.
Can I ask you what was your ailment?
I have depression and anxiety, so I'm like a modern day Bob.
Actually, you're like the modern day, because we all have it. So I will say that even when I first read the script, I said, you know, the things that are quoted in this book that was never written made sense. Baby steps, take a vacation from your vacation. You know, the things that were quoted from in that book by the writer, they all are terrific. And Baby Steps has entered the culture. We use it all the time. So for, I'm grateful that you said it, and I, wow, it's very, I can't tell you what it makes me feel like. But it would not surprise me, because first of all, laughter does that. And second of all, there really is no such thing as healthy or not healthy. None of us, not anyone in this room or anyone in your family, could actually have the chutzpah to say that they had achieved inner serenity and had no mental imbalance. Anyone here want to volunteer? Okay, so the very first thing you have to say when you come to a bipolar foundation or like manic depression, you got to say, there's no difference between us, you and us. I'm a manic depressive, and I used it because it was my reality. It was the only reality I knew. So I used it. And I'll tell you what they did. I was approached by a foundation to talk about my manic depression. They called it bipolar, which I hate, because I've been calling myself, you know, a manic depressive. That, to me, told the world. So they said to me, we want you to talk about your shame and your stigma and the difficulty of coming out of the closet and how you dealt with that and your strangeness and your alienation. And I said, you got the wrong guy. I said, I surf my manic depression. And I did. And I accepted it as my reality and said, okay, that's me, and let's deal with it. And I did. And I loved being me, which meant I loved being a manic depressive. I had friends who used to say, okay, it's time for us to get the circus cables out and tie them around his ankles and pull him gently back to earth. Because I would start a talk, and I would do this, and then I would do this, and then I was up, and then I was talking, and they would gently pull me back to earth. Okay, that was me. So what? I wasn't worried. What worried me was that I could go to a psychiatrist who would fall asleep while I was talking to him, which happened. Or a psychiatrist who would not recognize my existence if we were coming up to his office in the same elevator. I didn't exist until the door was open and I was in. And I was moving from LA to New York, and I had a really good doc. And he said, don't take the first psychiatrist you meet. Go shopping, he said. He said, the best thing to do is to go to the head of Beth Israel and get 5 names. Okay, that's what I did. I went to Beth Israel, chairman of the department, and I told him what I was looking for. And he was very, not cold, but he was very, And he said, am I supposed to know you? And I said, well, I'm an actor. And he didn't. And the next week, I won the Academy Award. And I came into his office and he said, I know who you are. And then he said, you know, I don't think I should give you the 5 names. I'd like you to come to me. I said, wait, whoa, no. He actually did say that. And so I didn't do that. And the second guy I went to in New York was a guy who was efficient and very New York, East Side. And he said, And who is your doctor in Los Angeles? And I mentioned his name. And he got up and he went to a big red book. I don't know what it was. But a big red book. Opened the book. No. No, he says. Really? And then I gave him 45 minutes. And I had always promised I'd give each guy 2 hours. And the second time I came to visit him, I was late because of the traffic and because I had been in a far part of the town. I was 10 minutes late. And he opened up the door and I said, I'm so sorry. I have been shopping for antiques. I've been shopping for psychiatrists. I've been shopping. And he goes, don't you ever say that. What? Don't you ever. That is so disrespectful. And I said, wait a minute. My doctor told me to use that phrase. And he said, let's cut the shit, Richard. You are a very sick man. This is a true story. And I said, I mean, my ass wasn't in the chair yet. My knees up. Let's cut the shit. You are a very sick man. And I went, and I went to the door and I turned and I said, you are not the only used car salesman in town. Fuck you. And I found a doctor. And he was smart. And he would say things to me like, I said to him once, you know, I have a feeling that I'm scamming you to give me the right drugs I want. And he looked up at me and he said, I'm your doctor, I'm not your dealer. And then we found what we needed. And it was great. And a year later I said to him, you know, you could call us a success. And he looked at me and said, why? And I said, because you have given me more courage than I ever thought I would have. And he said, it's not courage I give you. It's the absence of anxiety. That phrase I have deeply embedded in my heart. As much, and it means as much to me as the serenity. Great doctor. Why am I telling you this? I don't have any idea. We're out of time. I haven't even gotten out of Mesa. Why, is there another group coming
in? Well, the Comic-Con's almost over.
Well,
do you want to
not moving.
You want to take one more question?
Yeah.
One more question for Mr. Dreyfuss.
Who is the most urgent question? Uh-oh. Yeah? You fuck with me, I'll kill you. That's the most really urgent. Okay. Yeah.
Recently, I saw the movie The China Syndrome. And I read an article on the Rolling Stone from Michael Douglas saying, originally you were supposed to be a starring character in that movie, and that at the last minute, for some reason, according to him, you got cold feet, didn't want to be in the movie, and you dropped out. I was wondering, from your perspective, what happened?
When was this horrible?
I have to check my phone. I don't remember the exact date.
Was it recently?
It was probably 10 years ago.
He's lying. I was supposed to play this part, and he drove over to my house one day, and he said, I don't think you actually deserve the salary we've agreed to. And I said, what? And he said, you're too expensive. I said, so are you telling me I'm fired? What are you telling me?
And he said, I just think you're not right because it's too expensive for us to pay you that money. I said, well, I guess you won't then. And he then cast himself in the part. And I will tell you, that's the first time I ever heard that. And that's a truth about me and Michael that we never have talked about. I've seen him a couple of times. But he just plucked me out of the cast and put himself in. Now, he had the right, he was the producer, you know, he had whatever. And why he did it, I think it was because he realized it was a really good role. And, but that's what happened. And had I known a little more about legalities, I would have said, well, too fucking bad. Only $500,000. But I didn't until now. And that's the truth.
Well, I think that's a perfect place to end there. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Richard Dreyfuss.
Pay money to hear an evening which is just questions and answers.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
Seriously. Okay? Because I think I'm going to do this.
Yeah.
Yeah. We just did. I could make money doing it. You would learn more because I always tell the truth.
Do a tour.
Leave them wanting more.
Do a tour.
Please make sure you tell them this is how you came in Buffalo, New York.
Thank you.
Thank you, Richard Dreyfuss.
We love you.